Hello and welcome to Global Review. I'm Sachin Chaturvedi. We bring to you weekly analysis of key global developments. This week was extremely important in terms of how countries are getting out of the US dollar dominance. The week was also very important because Brexit talks are reaching at their climax. We also found China responding through their white paper. All of that we would discuss in today's program. But as always, first, let's have a look at the headlines. US dollar shares, central bank holdings decline and position undermined as Venezuela to use euro for future transactions. Russia also plans to make settlements. US trade representatives open to trade talks with the EU, UK and Japan. UNCTAD releases its report, claims China attracted $70 billion, largest FDI recipient. India follows closely with $22 billion. North and South Korea reached agreement to modernize and connect railways, roads across borders. China sold $3 billion sovereign dollar bonds, third time in 30 years. Donald Trump blamed recent market crash on Federal Reserve and the narrow approach they have. Ramaphosa has promised to speed up land reforms in South Africa. Mexican President Andres Obrador has proposed USMCA trade deal to be called as TMAC. As we discussed in the headlines, there were several key developments and most of them were extremely important in terms of how the global narrative is being shaped. And this is what we discuss in our section Across the Globe. Shanghai Cooperation Organization recently met. They had extremely important points to contribute in terms of shaping this global narrative. Let's have a look at this report.
The 17th meeting of the Council of Heads of Government of Member States of the Shanghai Cooperation Organization, that is SCO, was held in Dushanbe, Tajikistan from October 11 to 12. An important outcome was the joint communique which assesses economic, political and security situations in the region. Apart from implementing the outcomes of the Qingdao summit earlier this year, the heads of the various delegations emphasized on implementing the SCO charter and SCO development strategy until 2025. SCO identified six areas of cooperation in a proposal raised by Chinese Premier Li Keqiang, namely security, multilateral economic cooperation and trade, industrial capacity, connectivity, innovation, and people-to-people ties. External Affairs Minister Sushma Swaraj made her intervention at the meeting on issues of terrorism, economic and sustainable development, capacity building and climate change. Swaraj highlighted terrorism as the most overwhelming threat to common goals of development and urged SCO members to base all infrastructure development projects, including connectivity initiatives, on the principles of respect for sovereignty, territorial integrity, consultations, good governance, transparency, viability and sustainability. Swaraj made a reference to the World Trade Organization and its centrality in the international trade regime, asserting the need to develop and push for trade and investment cooperation. India has been an ardent supporter of the 18th SCO Qingdao Summit leaders' appeal to youth against radicalization of youth and congratulated all members on the successful achievement of SCO Peace Mission 2018. Swaraj highlighted India-Afghanistan partnership for the development of a secure, inclusive and economically vibrant nation and welcomed the signing of the protocol of the SCO Afghanistan contact group on the sidelines of the Qingdao summit. She also maintained that India is determined to work together in the SCO on environmentally friendly energy alternatives to ensure sustainable development.
SCO is playing an extremely important role to shape the larger global narrative, which is key for all the developing countries to go forward. They are talking about the role that multilateral institutions should play. They are talking about inclusive economic growth, addressing the sustainable development goals dimension. They are also appealing to youth in terms of their role for economic development and integration of the region. As you saw in the report, our External Affairs Minister Sushma Swaraj, who led Indian delegation, also talked about Afghanistan. To discuss these issues, we are joined in the studio today by two eminent commentators on global affairs. We are joined in by Professor Gulshan Sachdeva, who teaches at Jawaharlal Nehru University. And we are also joined in here by Mr. S. Venkat Narayan, who is a prominent journalist. Let me start with you, Gulshan, in terms of what role you see SCO playing now and what are the key outcomes of this summit?
Well, you know, SCO is becoming relatively important, I think, in the last few years, and particularly for India. Now, if you look at the membership of the SCO, three major players, Russia, India, China now, I mean, we have been meeting in different other forums as well, in the BRICS as well as also in RIC. But the main focus here, when you see, you have a Central Asia and now also Afghanistan, Pakistan in the grouping. So the major issue, I mean, any kind of integration or any kind of grouping which is happening near us, obviously we have certain interest. And particularly Central Asia is a very important region for us, both historical, cultural, civilizational linkages, for potential of trade and commerce, at the same time also for energy linkages, and of course strategically this is also very, very important. So now, as I think your report mentioned, the major issues which were really discussed, you have Afghanistan, you have terrorism,
the SDGs,
terrorism, you know, SDGs, at the same time, right. Also connectivity.
Yeah.
Now, these are all issues which are really important for us as well as also for Central Asia.
Yeah.
Because, and if you look at, say, for example, in Afghanistan, now any positive outcome coming from Afghanistan would be very, very useful both for India as well as Central Asia.
So you think, Gulshan, by joining India has now contributed to the larger sort of agenda setting, not only in Central Asia, but also for the Asia as a whole, because of China and India being there?
Well, China, India, Russia, all three major players
exactly,
are there. At
yeah.
the same time, this area is important, you know, for energy, for strategic, location of this particular region.
Yeah.
Now, Central Asia, still it hasn't really evolved as such as an Asian kind of, because, you know, in East Asia still, I mean, there are different kind of groupings. But at the same time, if any kind of evolving Asian security and economic architecture, if one can visualize in the years to come, and I'm sure SCO would play an important role in that evolving scenario.
Mr. Venkat Narayan, how you view evolution of SCO as an organization and what role and connect you see from Indian perspective?
Sachin, SCO has been around since 2001.
That's right.
And we and Pakistan joined the SCO last year. Now, SCO is very important in global affairs because today it is the biggest in terms of geography, 3/5 of the Eurasian landmass, and practically every second human being on the planet lives in these countries, China, India, Russia, and the other Central Asian countries. And as Mr. Putin said last time the summit was held in Qingdao, the purchasing power of SCO countries is more than the G7 countries. See, so it is emerging as a very powerful military bloc, economic bloc, And the fact that they share borders, you know, it makes it a solid kind of institution. So in the years to come, with India being included, I'm very happy that we have been trying to get into that, and finally they agreed, and last year Pakistan and China were...
But you recall that when they invited, we had declined.
Yeah.
You remember that.
Yes.
But how you see, Mr. Venkat Narayan, India playing an important influential role, as Gulshan mentioned, India's emphasis on bringing in Afghanistan and the contact group that SCO now has established with Afghanistan, how you see that dynamics playing out?
See, for the first time, India and China are help training Afghan diplomats.
That's right.
You know, and the Chinese ambassador.
The
India,
Wuhan spirit.
Yes, Afghan Wuhan spirit.
Yeah.
And you know, the fact that Xi Jinping is coming, going to come to India for his informal summit early next year, and you know, the informal setting, Mr. Modi and Xi Jinping met on the sidelines of the Qingdao summit, and they decided again to expand our trade to $100 billion. And Xi Jinping promised that we will buy more non-basmati rice and a lot of sugar to neutralize the $60 odd billion trade deficit between the two countries. So, you know, these huge umbrella outfits enable leaders of all these countries to get together once a year. The foreign ministers also meet once a year. I think this is a wonderful thing. And the fact that, you know, half the world in terms of population is together, you know, and they call it the Alliance of the East.
Yeah.
And, you know, China keeps talking about treat us with respect and, you know, that kind of stuff. So China, Russia and India are also in the same kind of situation where they are demanding the global respect. The post-Second World War scenario that exists at the UN, the fact that they haven't expanded the Security Council and what it was in the late 40s and 50s continues to be like that. And we are still trying to get into the Security Council and so on. I think SCO will help India play a role in proportion to its stature as a large economy and also the world's largest democracy.
Great. On that pragmatic note, we would have to get into a break. Don't go away. There are many more important issues we would be bringing up. Welcome back. In this section, we pick up issues for analysis which are not so much in your newspapers. We call this Beyond the News. Today, we have picked up this great and extremely interesting story as it is unfolding, State of Brexit. Let's have a look at this report.
European Union summit held on October 17 to 18 continues to push for a clear deal as Britain exits the EU. With 162 days left for Britain's departure on March 29, 2019, UK and EU strive to formalise an exit agreement. By March 29, the deal should complete a ratification phase with an approval of minimum 20 out of 27 EU states, consent of the European Parliament and a vote on the deal in the UK Parliament. The mutually agreed transition phase will last till December 31, 2020. During this phase, the EU undergoes election in May 2019. UK-EU push for formal talks and prepare new regulations for immigration, customs and regulations. With 85% of the treaty negotiated, deadlock remains on the status of Irish borders and the oversight of the European Court of Justice. The issue of the EU-UK land border on the island of Ireland is to create a safety net by avoiding a hard border at Northern Ireland and retain closer cross-border ties achieved through the 1998 Good Friday Agreement. EU wants Northern Ireland to remain in the single market customs union until a new free trade agreement is in place. This is not acceptable to Britain as it creates a checkpoint for goods between Northern Ireland and the UK. Prime Minister Theresa May wants the entire UK in the customs union until the new agreement, which EU rejects, creating a deadlock. A no-deal Brexit, which would mean UK exits without a formal agreement and no transition period, can lead to electricity shortages on the island of Ireland, impact flights, pensions and food imports. An unfavourable deal for EU can disrupt transport and trade links as well as lead to a domino effect with other members making a similar exit. Uncertainty over Brexit outcomes has negatively affected the UK economy, leading to decreasing investor confidence and affecting real wages and productivity growth.
With 162 days left, task is becoming extremely complicated and difficult for Prime Minister May. The task is in terms of how to carry on the business and how to maintain calm. The constituents within the government are asserting for severing the ties with European Union immediately. The Commission is not agreeing. The challenge is also in terms of how and in what way Britain should carry on with four important things. One, the Prime Minister is extremely keen that we have economic continuity. She is also very keen that the customs union is allowed to be carried on, while her own ministers are opposing it. They do not want any kind of customs union to move forward. Prime Minister May has also sanctioned 40 to 50 billion pounds to support whatever programs Britain has commitment for within the EU framework. So she is trying to be nice to EU as Brexit details are being worked out. She's also trying to give extra powers and extra rights to the EU citizens who are based in Britain. So she's trying to maintain while the challenges both at domestic and also from the EU side are getting complicated. Professor Gulshan Sachdeva, in backdrop of this and the report that we prepared, what is your view on what kind of Brexit we are heading for?
Well, if I just follow your report and what you have just mentioned, as things stand today, it's quite clear that there is a Brexit deadlock. And as Lithuanian president, she mentioned during the summit, she said, we do not know what they want. At the same time, it seems they also do not know what they want. That's a problem. So, I think from the EU side, things are relatively clearer because what they have really realized that EU wants to move out from the EU, and these are certain conditions. There is a time period in which we can negotiate if you wish to negotiate certain things, otherwise you move out from the EU. Now, there is a lot of confusion within UK.
That's right.
Within Conservative Party itself, within the British politics. So now, I think to me, it's going to happen like this.
An Irish backstop as it is emerging.
This is just, I think, this is related.
Yeah.
Now, I mean, all these issues, whether, issue of their citizens or Brexit bill or the Irish border issue, I think they're all linked to some extent. I mean, the basic crux of the matter, as far as I see here, is, now, what EU thinks that if you are moving out by March 2019, you are out. Of course, I think more or less this has been agreed that there's going to be a transition period, which is going to be till 2020. It may be even extended further, maybe another 6 months or 1 year. So it means practically by the end of March next year, very little would happen because they are not part of Eurozone, they are not part of Schengen. So that's not going to affect, and there is going to be a transition period. So more or less things will remain as they are today.
Yep.
Now, the issue is beyond that, what is really going to happen? Now, the British, I think the point is they still want to remain within the single market.
They want to take all the advantages.
They want to take advantage from the single market.
That's
without
right.
taking the obligations.
Mr.
What the EU thinks is that you cannot be inside as well as outside. So if you want to be out, once you are out, then we can negotiate everything else. They won't continue till the time the new agreement is settled. I think that's the issue.
That's
everything
the
is related
issue.
To
Mr. Venkat Narayan, how you see this complication? And as when we are talking now today, the key negotiators from Prime Minister May's side, Dominic Raab, the Secretary for Brexit, has already articulated this morning a proposition that things are not moving forward and we would have to go for soft landing as far as Brexit is concerned. How you view these developments?
See, Sachin, Britain was one of the founding members of the European Union. It's also the first country in 45 years which has taken a decision on a minority vote.
That's
51
right.
point something.
That's right.
And so everything, when a union of 4.5 decades is breaking up, so everything they are doing is for the first time. It's too complicated. And we must remember only Wales favored to a large extent Brexit, whereas Scotland and Northern Ireland opposed it, you see.
Yeah.
Even Theresa May herself, before she became the Prime Minister, she opposed Brexit.
That's right.
A lot of people, actually voters, they thought that the referendum is not going to go forward. And suddenly, when the results came, they said, "Oh, we made a mistake. We should have gone."
Gone. But how you see, as predictions are coming in, that there would be if EU is not going to relent, as Gulshan was mentioning, that they are going to be tough this time. What would be the opportunities for India, like pharmaceuticals and even power supply is becoming a huge issue there. So at least on pharmaceuticals and others, India would have an opportunity.
Yeah, I mean, I wouldn't really look at it only from the Indian point of view. Sure, it is going to be very helpful for us pharmaceutically and so on. But the European Union, as such, is India's biggest trading partner today.
Yeah, that's right.
And of course, Shenzhen doesn't apply. The pound continues to rule in Britain. So if you're traveling in Europe, it's a hassle getting into it. You have to take a separate visa to get into Britain.
But that Britain never became part of. We are running out of time, Mr. Venkat Narayan. We would have to pick up Book of the Week. In our this section, Book of the Week, today we have picked up something interesting that has come out from China. The Facts and China's Position on China-US Trade Friction. Information Office of the State Council of Republic of China. Now, this is a new practice that China has come out with. And in last 8 years, more than 7 white papers have been issued on all different themes. They are as good as a book. And that's why we have picked up in today's our discussion. Professor Gulshan Sachdeva, what role white papers play, and particularly this white paper where China has given full facts and full perspective, not a one-pager press release, but full details on how China views this US-China trade war. And last week, we hosted Chinese delegations here explaining this white paper. How you view this?
Well, I think Chinese have, this is a very innovative way, I think they have found to communicate with the world.
And it's a quicker way.
It's a quicker way, at the same time, very authentic, official way one can, because there is any official way in China, but still this is the way you get, because what Chinese perhaps are feeling, that there is a lot of misinformation about China, because the media is dominated by the West.
Yep.
So obviously they need to come out with detailed analysis with figures and data and everything else, which should be picked up later on by researchers as well
Good.
As by media.
Mr. Venkat Narayan, what's your view?
See, China is trying to play the victim card. Let's face it, the trade with the United States is more than $700 billion. Out of the $21 trillion debt America is stuck with,
exactly.
$1.18 trillion are in treasury bonds from the Chinese, you see.
Yeah.
And the deficit in China's favor and against Soviet Union is more than $350 billion.
But this modality of communication, you agree and
They have been issuing white papers since 1949.
Exactly.
And, that's a different thing.
We are running out of time. We would have to stop here. You are seeing my Twitter handle on your screen. Please give us your comments and ideas. We would be back here next week, same time. Till then, a very goodbye. Thank you.